welcome. My name is Wouter Keijs, and it's a pleasure to have you all here at the first UT kickoff of the School of Regional Healthcare Transformation, a consulting but also informative session with you, the trailblazers in healthcare, people, colleagues, scholars, academics, but also R&D colleagues across the UT who are all involved in healthcare. This group is a growing group. The University of Twente has a legacy in healthcare and healthcare transformation, you could say. And today we get together with one purpose, to have us all contribute to the thinking of what can we do, how should we go about with this School of Regional Healthcare Transformation. I'll be your host today. There are more hosts. We also have Theo Tonen, one of our deans, present. And first but not least, I have to tell you that this event is a contribution and a collective effort of a lot of people. And actually, this is one of the first times I've been here the last year, and happy to be here back on campus. So I hope to see you soon. We hope to see you soon also to contribute further for this innovative event. Participants today, we regard you as the trailblazers, the trailblazers in healthcare transformation. Why? That answer will be presented by yourself and by people we have invited to tell us from the field of healthcare in the Netherlands, to tell us why we are needed. The School of Healthcare Transformation initially is, well, a rogue initiative. It's not a formalized initiative. We'll dig into this later. It's an initiative with a handful of people, starting with Theo Tonen, Marion Kamp, Erwin Hans, of course, our colleagues from TechMed Center, in the person of Jouke Tamsma. And these people got together with you know, navigating the question, can we do more? Can we do more when it comes to our knowledge at the University of Twente, our experience and our intertwinement in healthcare? Can we do more? And Theo, if I may ask you, when did it all start?
Well, for me, it started 5 years ago. Actually, I realized March 2016, when at the time I was also the dean of IGS, the Institute for Governance Studies. And then we started to have a number of workshops on the what later became our five research teams within the faculty. And one of them was the topic on health BMS. And you said earlier, Twente has a tradition in healthcare transition. Well, true, but more so even in health technology. And I think we have felt that we should do something with them, and we've done a lot already with it. But then I also realized that that technology potentially not only needed to be implemented or used, or that we're not talking about e-health only, but that it potentially, together with the economic forces that are there in the healthcare sector, that potentially a whole transformation was needed. So I was looking at the presentation I did already contained the institution of I think I call it the Institution for Healthcare Transition for the first time around, stressing that we should not only focus on health, but also on the organizational, the business, the political, the administrative, the governance, the leaderships, the business aspects of it. Well, that was a long time ago. And then, of course, you hope that an idea like that starts to float, to work, and many of those ideas that we have initiated then in the meantime did, but then still that kept in mind until I ran into some people, and one person in particular who had all kind of ideas in this area, how we could potentially develop that. And according to me, that was a year ago, but I guess you know better than I do.
Well, yes,
I think when we started for the first time to talk about this.
Yeah, the first time I think we met was also in a studio, when you gave an interview on healthcare transformation with Paul van Liemt, one of the national reporters.
Yeah, at least in the preparation to that. That's, and then we discovered that we had a lot in common. And from there on, we said, okay, let's try to do this and try to lift this off the ground. In the meantime, we were already working on a lot of things. We both agreed on the fact that we should do this together with practice, with the practice community, with the people in practice. We knew a lot of the same people, and that we really should build it up and creatively. That this was not something from the top down, but that we had to build up a community, both for people internal and external. And since we were also working on transforming PLD, professional learning and development, into and in the context of the shaping strategy of this university, Shaping 2030, to pay more attention to lifelong learning, I thought, well, this could be the spearhead initiative in triggering this.
Because there is a lot of innovative work being done, not only on the healthcare side, but also on the educational side. I forgot to mention PLD and the person of Dick Wijnvind and his team, who also contributed very profoundly in this initiative. So professional learning development is a BMS, faculty of BMS activity, but CELT, our colleagues from the educational support, also have a lot of ideas on community learning and also lifelong learning.
Yeah, well, that's actually what happened. The PLD at a given moment found its own niche in delivering some professional masters, all well-known, risk, resilience, public management, but it was ready for innovation. And so that's why we repositioned and are repositioning still PLD in the context of the ambition of this university to become more active in lifelong learning. And that transition, that's also why Marion is involved in that as director at the moment, that we are really trying to reposition that and fit it into the modern ambitions of this university. And that's not only attention for professionals, but that you give, that you embed it in lifelong learning.
But that's new, because when I was studying 20 years ago at the university in Nijmegen, Radboud University, there were students, there's staff, nothing in between. And so after you graduate, you go into society. But now we try to, or the University of Twente is trying to go into society more earlier?
Yeah, well, it's not, I don't think it's new. I think PLD in that sense was already an early front runner in terms of building up these executive programs.
Executive programs.
And also these executive masters, these professional masters, as you call them. But what's new now is that we're modernizing in the wake of the new strategy, which I've already started to talk, shaping, started to talk 2-3 years ago about it. And then people would like to do it more in terms of interaction with the people, so more type of community learning. So reshape, actually, the professional learning into lifelong learning activities. And in that context, we have to address a lot of new issues indeed, and this could be a very good experiment in that way also.
Because there's much more. I mean, getting to talk with you about this, and we've done this several times, of course, but there's also Design Lab and DECMET and all these initiatives that are institutionalized, you could say, in a very new era of scholarly thinking and doing. Yeah. So reaching out into society with our academic knowledge and creativity, working together, maybe even vice versa.
Yeah.
Taking people or having people over and working with Philips Medical Systems, with Siemens, with many other corporations and businesses to do stuff.
But also to develop the mechanisms for doing this. So the whole notion of micro-credentials that people are talking about, that you can build up snippets of working, which eventually are then being validated after 3, 4, 10 years into some kind of a degree. These are the new kind of concepts which are being developed. You mentioned TechMed. We have a close collection with them, so I'm happy that they're supporting us. So we do this jointly. I'm also a member of the strategic board there. So we discussed this extensively, and they also found that there is a need within the community which is broader than, of course, the field where they're very well developed already in this area, in terms of professional learning, in terms of the healthcare technologies.
It's
broader.
Could you say that academia across the globe is transforming itself as well? Because the economics of an academic is writing papers, mentoring young PhD students to create more great research, and also creating opportunities by proposals and grant proposals.
Yeah, that used to be the case, but I think already, particularly at this university, the whole entrepreneurial spirit already means that we were early in that this university was early in changing that. That's not only publications and books and lecturing that matters, but that also entrepreneurship, startups, and innovation and really impact matters. And I think that's taken up now under shaping one step further. That needs to be innovated. We need to stay a little bit ahead also, and we need to build on the strong points of this university. So that means also that indeed in the way we organize our teaching on the long run, in the way that we gather our alliances externally, you don't get a grant these days anymore by sitting in your desk, behind your desk, and going to MBO and no, you don't, and writing them down and sending them in. You have to build networks. You have to build alliances. We are very successful in it. I mean, if you look in doing that already, if you look at the philosophy program that we have, the heavyweight as they call a grant that we have, Zwaartekracht. So that requires that you build coalitions, and people now come to universities, and that's what a lot of people expect more, also for their expertise and their training, retraining, rebuilding, re-educating people, then not only for the products or the artifacts which are being produced by a technical university or for the publications, as you say. I think a lot, I can see that strategically, that many, many more firms, also governments, are approaching the university because they constantly need to update and upgrade the competencies of their workforce.
If you're a scholar nowadays, if you're one of our colleagues, and I know, I mean, I got to know many of them the last year, talking about their plans and you know, going about with colleagues at the university and also outside. And you're a real, like an old-fashioned, I want to write papers, I want to do proposals and teach and mentor PhD students. How can you help those colleagues? I'm one of them, partly, because I really like the research, I really like the teaching. How can we proceed and transform to this new type of scholar?
No, it is not only me. I mean, I guess that is a whole system, the way it is developing, and we try to develop that. I mean, also, for example, central business development is with Geert de Wulf. It's not for nothing that a dean has now been taking over that, because it's been linked to the working floor. They know what's happening at the working floor within the faculties, and so increasingly they support us, or you, or the people in the faculty, to set up these kind of consortia and teams in order to also mobilize external resources for that.
What about
Belt is also now being remodeled in trying to support everything so that we can build up these, what I would call shaping initiatives, or what I've called shaping initiative in the context of BMS, which we should definitely do together with the technical faculties, and in this case, particularly also all those who are connected to TechMed.
Yes, but also technical medicine.
And let me add for that, that's also the way we're going to invest our resources.
What about micro-credentials? This is something that's going around on campus, but also outside.
Yep.
Is this a new scholarly economic?
No, it's relatively old already.
It is.
Phoenix University did it already for a very long time.
What is it?
Well, micro-credentials is that you do not a standard course, that you go to a lecturing hall, but that you do some activities in the course of your career together with some accredited institutions, and then you can tip them off, and then you get a passport or something like that, not vaccination passport, but another passport, in which you then can fill it in, and at a given moment you achieve a certain amount of, say, call it credits. We used to do call that credit points. And the difference is also that has come with the notion of ECIU, the entrepreneurial university, and where we're working with the other universities, various other universities in the Netherlands, in Europe, and we are the only one in the Netherlands that that does it this way. And then we try to create projects for students, but those are for regular students, I mean for undergraduate and graduate students, not necessarily postgraduate students, who are then going to a certain place and do comparatively on a certain topic, for example, healthcare transformation, to compare them. They get the micro-credentials for that, and together these micro-credentials then eventually contribute.
So it helps your career.
But you can also use this as a way of organizing your postgraduate education, not being the PhD, but the professional education, so that people don't have to take every Friday, go to the classroom or go to Utrecht or come to the campus in order to take a class. But and if you can combine that with community learning, you can do a lot of that in practice. So in that sense, it is a different way in which we are conceiving. And actually, for people in healthcare, that should be not too strange, because a lot of people in the hospitals, I don't have to tell you, they do their co-schappen, and that's how they earn, basically, their micro-credentials. Now, what we would like to do is to do that outside the safety.
Well, bad news for me, I was too late. I did my PhD only a year ago when we first met in that period. On healthcare transformation. But now you're saying that standing here could add to my academic career.
Well, it still can. I mean, it is a continuing thing. That it goes on after your PhD. I mean, afterwards, the PhD is more and more becoming a starting.
It makes my day. Thank you. Can we translate this to healthcare transformation?
No, that was, I was trying to ask that to you. Because, of course, I would be curious now to hear from you how you look at it. Because we started, when was it? It was about a year ago that we for the first time started to talk. I remember because it was in a time when we still, that was about the last time I was on campus too. And the COVID was just starting. And then we started to talk about it and we discovered some kind of things. And then me and them said, okay, now let's go. Let's join forces and see how we can develop this. What would you be your
My take on it.
Your take on it.
Yes. Healthcare transformation in the research I was involved in is defined not as innovation or implementation. Healthcare transformation is a grand social change. And I think we are building on that perspective. The School of Regional Healthcare Transformation is building on the definition of transformation not being only implementing good stuff and good technology, but it's a grand social change. It's more than technology. It's more than changing economics. It is roles and responsibilities. It is laws and regulations that have to be redesigned together. It is also about behavior, the way we've been trained and been educated and still are in a certain way in healthcare. I'm a medical doctor by training. I don't see patients anymore. I see doctors and others in healthcare to help them with transformation. And I think today it's a kickoff moment that we visualize that the expertise that we have at the University of Twente can help here, because all this perspective is needed to elaborate a new way of collaboration in healthcare towards a regionally based complex adaptive system. And this is something, it's really difficult. It's a wicked problem, as they say it. At the moment you start to work on it, you will not know what's next. And many actors and stakeholders in healthcare are dealing with this problem. And what we think, and Theo and me and this rogue, this white wolf bunch of people really think that the expertise, the profound expertise that we have at this university in collaboration but also other universities can help. And we'll see later in this session that it really is the case. Because implementation as being a grand social change is a real difficult thing. It entails fear of loss, fear of position. It entails dealing with hierarchy. It entails using each other to redefine who's the boss, so to say. So that's, I think, my take on transformation.
Yeah.
So I think this is what we are going to do with the school. Does it relate to your vision?
Well, I guess we have to add a little bit to the regional dimension, because we talked to that extensively. It's my hobby. I used to be as a professor in public administration in the deep past, paid a lot of attention. But what struck me, and particularly became more and more obvious during the development of COVID, and how these shifting dimensions between the national level and the local level are becoming increasingly important, and how well is that organized. So also for me, there was indeed a strong institutional aspect to it, apart from a professionalization aspect, apart from a technology aspect, apart from a business aspect, apart from a logistical aspect. And so, yeah, you're saying that rightfully, that we have all the expertise potentially in the house, as long as it's being combined in a new way, of the faculty, together with the people collectively working on the technology in the TechMed Center, to do this kind of thing. So we should try to make something out of that.
The proof is in the eating. That's what we thought, working our way to today. That's what we thought. The proof is in the eating. Let's ask people that are literally paid to have this vision as well, or maybe not.
Yep.
So we went outside in the field and asked a bunch of what we call executives, bestuurders in healthcare. Let's see three of them, and maybe later you can see more of what their message is to us.
We hebben op dit moment een zorgsysteem wat heel goed is, maar niet duurzaam naar de toekomst. Dus dat betekent de antwoorden van vandaag zijn niet de antwoorden die morgen zinvol zijn. Wij zijn op zoek naar manieren om antwoorden te kunnen geven op toekomstige vragen. Wij zitten elke dag in de praktijk. Wij zitten elke dag in de vraagstukken van nu. We zijn op zoek naar zekerheid naar de toekomst. Die is er niet. We hebben daar een visie over. Maar het zou heel mooi zijn als de school ons gaat helpen om juist de informatie die we vandaag hebben in het perspectief van de toekomst te plaatsen, om van daaruit ons nieuwe mogelijkheden, nieuwe denkwijzen en nieuwe oplossingen te bieden, zodat wij weer handvatten krijgen om de eerste stap naar de toekomst te maken. Jullie zijn cruciaal nodig. Jullie hebben ons nodig om die praktijk ook te integreren in jullie academisch werk. Laten we elkaar helpen. Succes.
Nou, ik vind het vanuit mijn ervaring en kennis als huisarts, als wetenschapper, als toezichthouder in de zorg, als bestuurder in de zorg, vind ik het ontzettend belangrijk dat sociaal-wetenschappelijke kennis en ook technologische kennis, dat naar de praktijk wordt gebracht. Omdat heel veel dokters in mijn geval, maar ook verpleegkundigen en andere zorgverleners, daar gewoon heel weinig van weten en ook heel weinig beseffen wat dat ze verder kan brengen. Dus dat lijkt me een heel belangrijke opgave voor jullie opleiding.
Beste mensen van de School of Regional Healthcare Transformation. De zorg staat voor grote uitdagingen. Als we niks hebben, natuurlijk, we werken in een van de beste zorgstelsels. We leven in een van de beste zorgstelsels van de wereld. Maar omdat dat zo is, neemt de zorgvraag toe. Het aantal mantelzorgers neemt af. De arbeidsmarkt wordt krapper. Dus als we het zo blijven doen, dan gaan we met z'n allen op de afgrond af. En dat willen we niet. Dus daarvoor zijn we bij elkaar. Dat is één. Het goede nieuws is, we weten allang hoe we ons daaruit kunnen transformeren. Dat heet de juiste zorg op de juiste plek. Of waardegedreven zorg. Nou, daar zijn we het ook allemaal over eens, blijkt in Nederland. Maar het goede nieuws is ook dat we daar ook al concrete voorbeelden van hebben in de praktijk. Op proeftuingebied. Waaruit blijkt dat dat gewoon kan. Maar slechte nieuws is dat we er nog slecht zijn in implementeren en opschalen. En dat is eigenlijk transformeren. Van proeftuin naar een massale beweging, naar een nieuw normaal. Daar heb je dus transformatie voor nodig. En transformeren is leren. Transformeren is reflecteren. Dus daar is één van de belangrijke pijlers is dat alles wat er aan wetenschappelijke kennis beschikbaar is, dat in die praktijk wordt getrokken. Zodat die praktijk kan reflecteren aan de hand ook van alle wetenschappelijke kennis. Andersom, hè, met alle eer aan het grote belang van fundamenteel wetenschappelijk onderzoek, daar doe ik niks aan af, maar waar we hiervoor staan is dat die wetenschappelijke kennis ook daadwerkelijk op een manier wordt ingebracht dat die regionale zorgecosystemen, want het grootste deel van dat leren moet je regionaal doen. Wij doen landelijk dingen, er moeten ook dingen in de wijk. Maar het grootste deel bij de zorgtransformatie komt neer op regio's. dat regionaal gebeurt en dat die wetenschappelijke kennis ook daadwerkelijk op een dusdanige manier lerend in de praktijk wordt gebracht, dat de praktijk er ook vanaf dag 1 beter van wordt. Dat je dan ook direct impact maakt. En dat is spannend, denk ik, voor wetenschappelijke instituten, maar oh zo leuk, want dan kun je als wetenschapper niet alleen regelmatig artikelen maken, misschien zelfs wel promoveren of mooie boeken schrijven, maar ook elke dag thuis vertellen waarom jij met je wetenschappelijk werk ook die zorg weer een beetje beter hebt gemaakt. En dat is ongelooflijk betekenisvol werk, want dat is belangrijk voor alle 17 miljoen Nederlanders. Ik wens jou ongelooflijk succes mee. Het mooie is ook, dit is de eerste. Leren, regionaal leren, dat is de toekomst van het transformeren van de zorg. En nou ja, jullie hebben daar een belangrijke koplopersrol in. En daar ben ik heel blij mee namens heel VWS. En we doen ook volledig mee. We leren mee met jullie. Maar voor nu heel veel plezier met dit ongelooflijk betekenisvolle initiatief.
Transform is learning, learning to transform, learning and transformation. It sounds so good in Dutch. Transformeren is leren. Here with me, our colleague Marloes Luttighuis. She's an educational support advisor, and we learn a lot about learning and how to learn, how to teach. What do you think? Healthcare transformation, is it something that you can teach?
Well, that's an interesting question. That depends a bit because it's a transformation, so it's not a set outcome that you have. It's a transformal process. So I think there's a lot of input that you need from different perspectives to get that all together. And that's also what we started with as a preparation to this session today, because we asked the participants to fill in a short survey.
If I may interrupt. A community of practice, a community of learning. That's the expertise that you have, and that you also work from to us, to what we are doing today and with the school, right?
Yes. So that's also the starting point of this session today, to get all the different perspectives together, also from all the participants, and to see what everyone can add, and to come up with new ideas and new solutions to get this transformation going, or get on the train that is already going, so to say. So we started with this survey to also get some input from what your expectations are, what your experience already is, but also what you already know. So how do you envision transformation, healthcare transformation? We requested that in the survey, but also this session is, of course, very interactive. So if you have something to add or you have any questions, please share them in the chat with us, because we have Dick Wijnvin in the control room, and he will take care of all the questions in the chat. So we will also contact him and get to know from him what you are thinking and what you want to add. So please feel free to do so. Let's start and take a look at the first question that we asked, and that is, what does healthcare transformation entail according to you? You can also see the slide, which is a short summary of all the responses. So yeah, first of all, of course, thank you for filling out the survey. But if we look at the responses, well, there's a lot of connecting or combining topics mentioned. So there's something mentioned about stakeholders and combining different stakeholder perspectives, getting the stakeholders together. It's about a culture, but also the change of the culture. It's about technology, but not only technology, because it has more than technology. There are other factors that are also important. And it's about increasing value. So how can this healthcare transformation increase value, not only for patients and clients, but also for employees and for everyone, for all those stakeholders that are involved in those in this transformation? So Wouter, if you look at this responses, what is the first thing that comes to mind?
I see a lot of academic power in it. I see a lot of perspectives. And I think where I come from, healthcare, in the white coat culture in hospitals or clinics, you're not trained to encompass these items, these domains, which are very unique in themselves. So the width and the depth of the responses that we got already that you briefly mentioned here, and we're looking at one of the screens, of course, is actually a reflection, maybe even a fingerprint of what we have at the University of Twente, I mean, and also other colleague academia.
Yeah. Okay, great. So I'm also curious to hear if there are any responses from the audience. So if it's possible, I would like to connect to Dick.
Dick.
And hear from him if there are any responses in the chat or any questions already that we can further
discuss.
Yeah,
of course. I have a very, there's a small discussion going on the chat at the moment. If transformation in healthcare is realistic. So this is a subject which might be also very valuable to discuss perhaps a little bit later with in the smaller groups. Because if we look at back at the time, and it's something what Sabina told us, we were not so quite successful in this. After that, we got a great remark from Remke Burry. He says there are still chances as long as technology and social sciences, et cetera, work together and put it on a regional level. So please put your comments on the chat and also your questions. But so far from here, back to you.
It's interesting. Can I respond to this?
Yes, because of course.
Is it realistic? I think if you look into history and regard the fact that Hippocrates has been the one that has been the founder of Western medicine as we know it, and the hierarchy as we know it in hospitals, the fact that we as consumers, as patients, like sheep, we get in line for hospitals to sit in waiting rooms. Of course, Corona has changed the latter, but the institutionalization as social sciences provides us a definition is so deep in healthcare. I'm a trained physician, and I was socialized in this community of physicians, and it's really a tough cookie to crumble. And so the fact that, let's go to this, to the video, that these people, they reach out and say, we need all of us at the same table to reinvent, makes transformation maybe a little bit realistic, not irrealistic, I think.
I hope. So it also has to do with crossing borders and looking further than your own discipline or your own topic of research, but also what are others doing and how can we combine our efforts and how can we then start that transformation?
A community,
indeed. Yeah, and I think that's also something that we asked in the second question, and that is about, well, which topics or themes do you think that should be incorporated in the curriculum of the school? And there you also see that it's about looking across borders, getting stakeholders together, how to manage those stakeholders, and it's also about change management. So it's an ongoing process, it's a change process, and you need to take that into account. It's about innovation, maybe also about entrepreneurship, and there are a lot of different disciplines, from financials, data, to psychology. So all those different disciplines are combined in this transformation. If you look at those topics that are mentioned already, does that also reflect your idea on what should be?
Yes.
In school?
I mean, you shouldn't have asked me this like 5 to 10 years ago, but now I know, and I know we need all these perspectives. We know change and change management, but it's not enough. It's also redesigning the way how we do economics in healthcare and business modeling and innovative perspectives in how we see healthcare as a business. So yes, I'm again, this is like a reflection of reality, as we saw in the video, and these are only three of the executives that we spoke with and the video during the break, or there are more.
Yeah,
they all say the same, they all say this. It's really nice.
Yeah, so that's a great result then already, that we see that those topics are aligned. And that also reflects on the next question, because we asked you some statements about, well, how you perceive the School of Regional Health healthcare transformation. And, well, we asked you, well, do you think that the school could be a relevant network for you and also your colleagues from your research department? And, yeah, I think that we can say that the majority agreed on that one. And also that you see that as a way that you as a researcher can contribute to society. And I think that really links to the video where also those stakeholders, those executives mention why this is so important and how this could be integrated. So
it's an echo of all the interviews we had over the last few months. About 40 people we interviewed. I mean, those were like really informal, you know, getting to know people and blah blah. But we all at the University of Twente, we all already work with healthcare professionals and executives in the field, but we want more.
Yeah.
And that's so like it's two communities talking to each other, and now maybe, well, that's the plan. Through the school, healthcare community and those scholars can cross-pollinate and further healthcare transformation as it is like an organic movement itself. But we can further it working together.
Shall we put that into action? Because, the next step is that we want to introduce this activity where we would like to divide you into subgroups. You will be automatically divided into a breakout group with some of the other participants. And there we would like to ask you to discuss, well, who would you like to meet in the school? In what kind of way? And why that specific group or that specific person that you would like to meet in the school? And we have five discussion leaders that will help you with this discussion, which is Michel Ehrenhardt, Petra de Weert Nederhof, Erwin Hans, Lara Carminati, and Marion Kamp. So they will be the hosts of these subgroups, and they will lead the discussion and get you going. We will do that for 20 minutes, and then after that, there will be a break. So there will be you will be transferred to the general plenary session again, but there will be a 15-minute break. So there's some time to get coffee or tea, but don't go away for too long because we also have a nice video that we will show you during the break. So also take a minute to look at the video. So if we're ready from the technical part, then I think we can now send you out to this breakout groups, and then see you back again in 35 minutes in total.
Zorgtransformatie is nodig. En dat is geen kwestie. Waarom? Redenen genoeg. Onze kranten staan er vol van. En zorgtransformatie is al lang niet meer alleen iets van de zorg. Maar dat betekent ook gezond zijn en gezond blijven. We praten dan dus ook over een brede maatschappelijke beweging. Dat betekent dat zorgtransformatie om diepgaande verandering vraagt. Van vele rollen, regels en de manier waarop we met elkaar omgaan. Deze complexe maatschappelijke verandering kunnen we dus en mogen we ook niet alleen overlaten aan zorgprofessionals, bestuurders en beleidsmakers in de zorg. Zij weten veel, maar geven ook aan dat zij kennis...
Beste collega's van de Universiteit Twente. Wat een fantastisch initiatief hebben jullie genomen met deze school. Ik wens jullie dan ook ontzettend veel succes, maar ook vooral heel veel plezier en genieten. Want het is natuurlijk wel een ontdekkingsreis wat je gaat doen. Wat zou ik mee willen geven als bestuurder van Radboud UMC, los van dat we graag samen met jullie optrekken natuurlijk in deze, is toch eigenlijk jezelf uitnodigen, nieuwsgierig zijn en durven te gaan zitten op de stoel van die ander. Om dat perspectief van die ander te nemen. Soms verras je dat, brengt je tot nieuwe creatieve inzichten. Verbindingen met mensen, met sectoren die je eigenlijk niet zo vertrouwd zijn. Hoe verrassend is dat als je dat bij elkaar legt met alle kennis en kunde die jullie hebben, wat er dan gaat gebeuren aan misschien nieuwe gedachten, nieuwe diensten, nieuwe producten. Dat zien we natuurlijk in het wetenschappelijk onderzoek. Die crossovers brengen eigenlijk de grootste stappen voorwaarts. Zo gaat het ook met gedrag, zo gaat het ook met systeemveranderingen. Dus laten we elkaar uitnodigen, een mooie gezelschap om goede noten te kraken en nieuwe creativiteit te creëren. Veel succes, veel plezier en tot ziens hoop ik. Dag!
Ik denk dat het enorm belangrijk is voor echte duurzame oplossingen voor de zorg. En dat gaat dus over transformatie. Dat je zorgt dat je, als er problemen zijn, inclusief gaat kijken naar welke scholars, welke mensen uit de universiteit kunnen hier nou iets zinnigs over zeggen. En dat betekent dus dat je mensen bij elkaar gaat brengen als technici. Mensen die verstand hebben van gedrag en sociologie. Mensen die verstand hebben van economie. Allerlei verschillende perspectieven. En dat je die rondom een probleem om tafel brengt. Transdisciplinair nadenkend. En zonder dat we dat soort beweging leren maken, zitten we te veel op ons eigen domein. En het is juist fantastisch om rond een probleem te merken dat je buurman een compleet andere kijk heeft dan jij. En de andere buurman weer een heel andere kijk. Die dingen bij elkaar leggend kun je oplossingen gaan uitkristalliseren en wegen inslaan en daarmee experimenteren, waarmee je echt verder komt. Veel verder dan vanuit alleen uit je eigen domein. Dus fantastisch dat er een school voor transformatie opgericht wordt die al die perspectieven bij elkaar gaat brengen. Vanuit de zorg sprekend, dat hebben wij nodig. Dankjewel.
Oké, dames en heren. Het ziekenhuis van de toekomst is een ziekenhuis zonder muren. We zullen zien, met name door data, dat steeds vaker de zorg echt door de organisaties heen, om de patiënt, om de burger heen georganiseerd gaat worden. Een enorme verandering, eigenlijk van het bed naar alles passend in de omgeving, om de mens thuis heen. Dat vraagt nogal wat voor die mensen in de ziekenhuizen. En de vraag is, hebben we daar niet de juiste hulp nodig? Bijvoorbeeld van mensen zoals jullie. Twee thema's wil ik even noemen. Innovatie vraagt om sociale transformatie, om andere vormen van leiderschap en andere vormen van elkaar leren en met elkaar omgaan. En hoe mooi zou het zijn als jullie je kennis inbrengen in de ziekenhuizen om de professionals te leren om die transformatie ook echt te maken. Om die verandering ook echt vanuit kracht te doorleven. Die hele sociale kant is superbelangrijk. Een tweede belangrijk punt is whole system in the room. Dus die veranderingen zullen plaatsvinden met andere partijen dan alleen het ziekenhuis of de burger-patiënt. maar ook een techbedrijf, ook een verzekeraar, ook een gemeente, ook een huisarts. En hoe is dat als die patiënten samen met dat ecosysteem komen in één kamer om een oplossing te bedenken met elkaar in plaats van langs elkaar vanuit de silo's? En daar hebben jullie natuurlijk ook met jullie kennis en expertise een superbelangrijke rol. Meer vanuit een labomgeving. Nou, in ieder geval vanuit de OFG Amsterdam, wij zouden supergraag die lijn naar Twente leggen. En weten zeker dat we ook heel veel van jullie kunnen leren. Dus zet hem op.
Zorg staat voor een enorme uitdaging. Dat is eigenlijk niks nieuws. En we weten eigenlijk dat we daarvoor een transformatie nodig hebben. En met dat kleine beetje iedere keer op keer innoveren wat we nu doen, gaan we er niet komen. En waarom we jullie nodig hebben, is om met ons te leren hoe we moeten transformeren. We hebben sociale innovatie voor nodig, we hebben technologische innovatie voor nodig. En we moeten leren hoe we in organisaties echt die stap gaan maken, mensen meenemen en kracht organiseren. En als ik heel eerlijk ben, zonder jullie kennis gaat ons dat niet lukken.
Ja, de TU Twente is een van de geweldige kennisinstituten die wij hebben in Nederland en die ook internationaal toonaangevend onderzoekswerk doen op tal van gebied. En zeker ook op het gebied van de geneeskunde. En wat alleen nog vaak veel beter kan, en daar daag ik jullie ook voor uit, is om al die kennis die jullie in dat instituut hebben opgebouwd in de loop der jaren, om dat ook voor zover dat relevant is, ja, zeg maar, om te zetten in voor patiënten en consumenten relevante waardeproposities. En dat betekent ook een stuk ondernemerschap. En wij zijn eigenlijk al in het hele land actief met start-ups en scale-ups. En ik zou jullie echt willen uitnodigen om daar veel meer de verbinding ook aan te gaan, zodat wij weer kunnen helpen van hoe doe je dat dan, hoe maak je een businessplan, waar haal je de financiering vandaan. Omdat ik denk dat als we dat gaan doen, dan hebben we daar straks niet de vruchten alleen maar van voor de Nederlandse patiënt, maar dan kunnen ook sommige van die ideeën uitgroeien tot internationale ondernemingen. En dat is dan weer een stukje motor van de economie van Nederland voor de toekomst. En ik kijk er naar uit om die samenwerking met jullie aan te gaan.
Zorgtransformatie is nodig. En dat is geen kwestie. Waarom? Redenen genoeg. Onze kranten staan er vol van. En zorgtransformatie is al lang niet meer alleen iets van de zorg. Dat betekent ook gezond zijn en gezond blijven. We praten dan dus ook over een brede maatschappelijke beweging. Dat betekent dat zorgtransformatie om diepgaande verandering vraagt. Van vele rollen, regels en de manier waarop we met elkaar omgaan. Deze complexe maatschappelijke verandering kunnen we dus en mogen we ook niet alleen overlaten aan zorgprofessionals, bestuurders en beleidsmakers in de zorg. Zij weten veel, maar geven ook aan dat zij kennis en kunde uit andere vakgebieden nodig hebben. Academici, experts, maar ook ervaringsdeskundigen kunnen hierbij helpen. De zorg is iets wat ons allemaal aangaat en zeker ook onze kinderen. Transformeren kost tijd en aandacht, maar alleen samen kunnen we de zorg verder brengen. Dit vraagt om een transformatie, ook van hen buiten de zorg. Doe je mee? Transformeren om samen de zorg te helpen transformeren?
We hebben op dit moment een zorgsysteem wat heel goed is, maar niet duurzaam naar de toekomst. Dus dat betekent dat de antwoorden van vandaag zijn niet de antwoorden die morgen zinvol zijn. Wij zijn op zoek naar manieren om antwoord te kunnen geven op toekomstige vragen. Wij zitten elke dag in de praktijk. Wij zitten elke dag in de vraagstukken van nu. We zijn op zoek naar zekerheid naar de toekomst. Die is er niet. We hebben daar een visie over. Maar het zou heel mooi zijn als de school ons gaat helpen om juist de informatie die we vandaag hebben in het perspectief van de toekomst te plaatsen, om van daaruit ons nieuwe mogelijkheden, nieuwe denkwijzen en nieuwe oplossingen te bieden, zodat wij weer handvatten krijgen om de eerste stap naar de toekomst te maken. Jullie zijn cruciaal nodig. Jullie hebben ons nodig om die praktijk ook te integreren in jullie academisch werk. Laten we elkaar helpen. Succes!
Nou, ik vind het vanuit mijn ervaring en kennis als huisarts, als wetenschapper, als toezichthouder in de zorg, als bestuurder in de zorg, vind ik het ontzettend belangrijk dat sociaal-wetenschappelijke kennis en ook technologische kennis, dat naar de praktijk wordt gebracht. omdat heel veel dokters in mijn geval, maar ook verpleegkundigen en andere zorgverleners, daar gewoon heel weinig van weten en ook heel weinig beseffen wat dat ze verder kan brengen. Dus dat lijkt me een heel belangrijke opgave voor jullie opleiding.
Beste mensen van de School of Regional Healthcare Transformation. De zorg staat voor grote uitdagingen. Als we niks hebben, natuurlijk, we werken in een van de beste zorgstelsels. We leven in een van de beste zorgstelsels van de wereld. Maar omdat dat zo is, neemt de zorgvraag toe. Het aantal mantelzorgers neemt af. De arbeidsmarkt wordt krapper. Dus als we het zo blijven doen, dan gaan we met z'n allen op de afgrond af. En dat willen we niet. Dus daarvoor zijn we bij elkaar. Dat is één. Het goede nieuws is, we weten al lang hoe we ons daaruit kunnen transformeren. Dat heet de juiste zorg op de juiste plek. Of waardegedreven zorg. Nou, daar zijn we het ook allemaal over eens, blijkt in Nederland. Maar het goede nieuws is ook dat we daar ook wel concrete voorbeelden van hebben in de praktijk, op proeftuingebied. Waaruit blijkt dat dat gewoon kan. Maar slechte nieuws is dat we er nog slecht zijn in implementeren en opschalen. En dat is eigenlijk transformeren. Van proeftuin naar een massale beweging, naar een nieuw normaal. Daar heb je dus transformatie voor nodig. En transformeren is leren. Transformeren is reflecteren. Dus daar is één van de belangrijke pijlers is dat alles wat er aan wetenschappelijke kennis beschikbaar is, dat in die praktijk wordt getrokken. Zodat die praktijk kan reflecteren aan de hand ook van alle wetenschappelijke kennis. Andersom, hè, met alle eer aan het grote belang van fundamenteel wetenschappelijk onderzoek, daar doe ik niks aan af, maar waar we hiervoor staan is dat die wetenschappelijke kennis ook daadwerkelijk op een manier wordt ingebracht dat die regionale zorgecosystemen, want het grootste deel van dat leren moet je regionaal doen. Wij doen landelijk dingen, er moeten ook dingen in de wijk. Maar het grootste deel bij de zorgtransformatie komt neer op regio's. Regionaal gebeurt en dat die wetenschappelijke kennis ook daadwerkelijk op een dusdanige manier lerend in de praktijk wordt gebracht, dat de praktijk er ook vanaf dag 1 beter van wordt. Dat je dan ook direct impact maakt. En dat is spannend, denk ik, voor wetenschappelijke instituten. Maar oh zo leuk, want dan kun je als wetenschapper niet alleen regelmatig artikelen maken, misschien zelfs wel promoveren of mooie boeken schrijven, maar ook elke dag thuis vertellen waarom jij met je wetenschappelijk werk ook die zorg weer een beetje beter hebt gemaakt. En dat is ongelooflijk betekenisvol werk, want dat is belangrijk voor alle 17 miljoen Nederlanders. Ik wens jou ongelooflijk succes mee. Het mooie is ook, dit is de eerste. Leren, regionaal leren, dat is de toekomst van het transformeren van de zorg. En jullie hebben daar een belangrijke koplopersrol in. En daar ben ik heel blij mee namens heel VWS. En we doen ook volledig mee, we leren mee met jullie. Maar voor nu heel veel plezier met dit ongelooflijke betekenisvolle initiatief.
Beste collega's van de Universiteit Twente. Wat een fantastisch initiatief hebben jullie genomen met deze school. Ik wens jullie dan ook ontzettend veel succes, maar ook vooral heel veel plezier en genieten. Want het is natuurlijk wel een ontdekkingsreis wat je gaat doen. Wat zou ik mee willen geven als bestuurder van het Radboud UMC, los van dat we graag samen met jullie optrekken natuurlijk in deze, is toch eigenlijk jezelf uitnodigen, nieuwsgierig zijn en durven te gaan zitten op de stoel van die ander. Om dat perspectief van die ander te nemen. Soms verras je dat, brengt je tot nieuwe creatieve inzichten. Verbindingen met mensen, met sectoren die je eigenlijk niet zo vertrouwd zijn. Hoe verrassend is dat als je dat bij elkaar legt met alle kennis en kunde die jullie hebben, wat er dan gaat gebeuren aan misschien nieuwe gedachten, nieuwe diensten, nieuwe producten. Dat zien we natuurlijk in het wetenschappelijk onderzoek. Die crossovers brengen eigenlijk de grootste stappen voorwaarts. Zo gaat het ook met gedrag, zo gaat het ook met systeemveranderingen. Dus laten we elkaar uitnodigen. Een mooie gezelschap om goede noten te kraken en nieuwe creativiteit te creëren. Veel succes, veel plezier en tot ziens, hoop ik. Dag.
Ik denk dat het enorm belangrijk is voor echte duurzame oplossingen voor de zorg. En dat gaat dus over transformatie. Dat je zorgt dat je, als er problemen zijn, inclusief gaat kijken naar welke scholars, welke mensen uit de universiteit kunnen hier nou iets zinnigs over zeggen. En dat betekent dus dat je mensen bij elkaar gaat brengen als technici, mensen die verstand hebben van gedrag en sociologie, mensen die verstand hebben van economie, allerlei verschillende perspectieven. En dat je die rondom een probleem om tafel brengt, transdisciplinair nadenkend. En zonder dat we dat soort beweging leren maken, zitten we te veel op ons eigen domein. En het is juist fantastisch om rond een probleem te merken dat je buurman een compleet andere kijk heeft dan jij. En de andere buurman weer een heel andere kijk. Die dingen bij elkaar leggend kun je oplossingen gaan uitkristalliseren en wegen inslaan en daarmee experimenteren waarmee je echt verder komt. Veel verder dan vanuit alleen uit je eigen domein. Dus fantastisch dat er een school voor transformatie opgericht wordt die al die perspectieven bij elkaar gaat brengen. Vanuit de zorg sprekend, dat hebben wij nodig. Dankjewel.
Oké, dames en heren. Het ziekenhuis van de toekomst is een ziekenhuis zonder muren. We zullen zien, met name door data, dat steeds vaker de zorg echt door de organisaties heen, om de patiënt, om de burger heen georganiseerd gaat worden. Een enorme verandering, eigenlijk van het bed naar alles passend in de omgeving om de mens thuis heen. Dat vraagt nogal wat voor die mensen in de ziekenhuizen. En de vraag is, hebben we daar niet de juiste hulp nodig? Bijvoorbeeld van mensen zoals jullie. Twee thema's wil ik even noemen. Innovatie vraagt om sociale transformatie, om andere vormen van leiderschap en andere vormen van elkaar leren en met elkaar omgaan. En hoe mooi zou het zijn als jullie je kennis inbrengen in de ziekenhuizen om de professionals te leren om die transformatie ook echt te maken, om die verandering ook echt vanuit kracht te doorleven. Die hele sociale kant is superbelangrijk. Een tweede belangrijk punt is whole system in the room. Dus die veranderingen zullen plaatsvinden met andere partijen dan alleen het ziekenhuis of de burgerpatiënt. Maar ook een techbedrijf, ook een verzekeraar, ook een gemeente, ook een huisarts. En hoe is dat als die patiënten samen met dat ecosysteem komen in één kamer om een oplossing te bedenken met elkaar in plaats van langs elkaar vanuit de silo's? En daar hebben jullie natuurlijk ook met jullie kennis en expertise een superbelangrijke rol. Meer vanuit een labomgeving. Nou, in ieder geval vanuit OFG Amsterdam. Wij zouden supergraag die lijn naar Twente leggen. En weten zeker dat we ook heel veel van jullie kunnen leren. Dus zet hem op.
Zorg staat voor een enorme uitdaging. Dat is eigenlijk niks nieuws. En we weten eigenlijk dat we daarvoor een transformatie nodig hebben. En met dat kleine beetje iedere keer op keer innoveren wat we nu doen, gaan we er niet komen. En waarom we jullie nodig hebben, is om met ons te leren hoe we moeten transformeren. Daar hebben we sociale innovatie voor nodig, daar hebben we technologische innovatie voor nodig. En we moeten leren hoe we in organisaties echt die stap gaan maken, mensen meenemen en kracht organiseren. En als ik heel eerlijk ben, zonder jullie kennis gaat ons dat niet lukken.
Ja, de TU Twente is een van de geweldige kennisinstituten die wij hebben in Nederland en die ook internationaal toonaangevend onderzoekswerk doen op tal van gebied. En zeker ook op het gebied van de geneeskunde. En wat alleen nog vaak veel beter kan, en daar daag ik jullie ook voor uit, is om al die kennis die jullie in dat instituut hebben opgebouwd in de loop der jaren, om dat ook voor zover dat relevant is, om te zetten in voor patiënten en consumenten relevante waardeproposities. En dat betekent ook een stuk ondernemerschap. En wij zijn eigenlijk al in het hele land actief met start-ups en scale-ups. En ik zou jullie echt willen uitnodigen om daar veel meer de verbinding ook aan te gaan, zodat wij weer kunnen helpen van hoe doe je dat dan? Hoe maak je een businessplan? Waar haal je de financiering vandaan? Omdat ik denk dat als we dat gaan doen, dan hebben we daar straks niet de vruchten alleen maar van voor de Nederlandse patiënt, maar dan kunnen ook sommige van die ideeën uitgroeien tot internationale ondernemingen. En dat is dan weer een stukje motor van de economie van Nederland voor de toekomst. En ik kijk er naar uit om die samenwerking met jullie aan te gaan.
Welcome back. Hopefully you had a fruitful discussion in the subgroups. But before we will go into the summary of that, I would like to switch and connect to the control room, so to Dick. Dick, can you maybe tell me what is going on? Are there any discussions or remarks in the chat?
Yeah, I'm doing fine at the moment. It's very cold here outside, but okay, I have to stay here for the next hour. But there are some questions about, also the movie talked about this, social and technological innovation in the School of Regional Healthcare Transformation. We've heard a lot and we've seen a lot about social aspects, and what the people are really, really a little bit curious about is what is the connection with the technical faculties of the university. So perhaps you can give some more information about that and your ideas about it.
Yeah, yep. I think that's a great question for you, Wouter.
Well, originally I'm not really a tech-oriented professional. However, after the last two decades or so, my colleagues and myself, we focus a lot on e-health, or how to use innovative technologies and ICT and the internet, of course, to help patients, to help professionals in healthcare. But I think it's a relevant question, because you know if you look from far to our university, you see a lot of technology, and we have a lot of technical oriented professionals and experts, scholars and R&D people on our campus. However, they also know a lot about implementation. So it's not only do your thing, designing, developing, testing, put it in the box and control, and plug and sell it. But it's also about what's the impact of this technology. And this expertise about implementation, how to make healthcare technology work in real life, is also embedded in these groups of people. So the School of Regional Healthcare Transformation is combining this knowledge about implementation, how the impact can be helped in such a way that professionals, organizations in healthcare, and in the end, of course, you, me, us as citizens, clients, patients, are being served.
Yes, so it's also about not only technology, but also the embedding of technology.
And its impact, yes.
To impact it, yeah. Okay, thank you. Dick, are there any other things from the chat?
I have a very important question, because Mr. Siesling is leaving very shortly, so he really wants to have an answer before he's leaving at 5 o'clock. He is curious about the region. What's your definition of region? Because a lot of operations, for example, take place in one hospital and are for the complete Netherlands, for example. So perhaps you can tell a little bit more about this. What is the definition of a region?
Yes, so
for me,
yeah.
That's an important question, and I think it also relates to why the question: why is the School of Regional Healthcare Transformation regional? Of course, healthcare is not only regional, although we, as individuals, we live, we go to school, we study, we work, we die in one region. Mostly. So what you've seen over the years, especially the investments the European Commission has done in innovation in healthcare, in transformation in healthcare, is mainly regional. However, there are items, domains, there are lines of thinking there. You need a overall system also to monitor, to service regional healthcare. Transformation is learning. Transformation is a social movement, mostly, not only, but mostly. And this is something that you do together in a region. So hence, the school's name is embedded in the regional perspective, but not only. And well, there's another thing. As University 20, we of course, maybe we first focus on the Dutch healthcare system. Beyond, after this year of founding the school, we certainly go outside, and also there we find a lot of interesting views we can and experiences we can use in Holland, and vice versa.
And do you also see an international perspective then for the school?
Definitely. First Holland.
That's First Holland. Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. So you had a discussion in the subgroups on who you would like to meet in the school, in what kind of way and why. And I would like to give the discussion leaders the opportunity to shortly summarize what was discussed and what the main points were. And I would like to start with Michel Ehrenhardt. Hopefully we can connect to Michel now. Hi, Michel. Hi, good to see you. So can you shortly summarize what was discussed in your group?
So in short, with Malouk, Marika as students, Grianne and Anke from more the health domain, and Raymond and myself from the business domain, I think the core thing that that came up with us is to bring people together. So in that sense, this is already a success. But the reason for it is that we need more integration across disciplines, because it's not just the technology, it's also the adoption implementation, it's also regulation. So this collaboration is really important. But one key question there was, we can't do everything. So an answer we didn't have, but one key question is, who should we target? So they have clear targeting in that sense. In relation to the targeting, but also collaboration, is that there is a BMS health research program. Of course, there's healthcare education, not just in health sciences, also in other domains. There is valorization. So how do we bring those together? So will the school be focused mostly on healthcare valorization outreach? Or will it also be related to these other things? That's something to really consider. Furthermore, the links to practice, that's really something which is a key thing. We thought to really have good links to practice, to maybe have PLD, to develop nice training, to get more engagement there. So really having partners in developing learning there. And then finally, some points that popped up is that we thought that, the three main points that we discussed was that needs change. So when there's new technology, needs change again. So that's something to really consider. A shift to more personalized healthcare was a key topic that was mentioned, and having space for entrepreneurial initiative. So those were the main points.
Wow, that's a lot that you've discussed. So that to me, it sounds like a very fruitful discussion. So indeed, how to connect and get people together as a starting point for the school, but also as a next step, how to target it and who should be the target group, and how to get all the disciplines together, how to make it innovative and entrepreneurial. Yes. Great to hear. Yeah, thank you very much for this summary. Shall we continue to the next, which is Petra de Weert? So Petra, can you also shortly share what was discussed in your subgroup?
Yeah, of course, Marloes, thank you very much. Our breakout room was actually very full. We had Bart Nieuwenhuis, René Torvli, Klaas Stek, Sabine Siesling, Michel Linnenbank, Pieter-Jan Klok and Guus Montfort. So we had to be quick. But actually, we also had a lot of ideas that matched. Our discussion, and Rick van Buren. I will not forget him. Our discussion started with Rick's proposal to, first of all, bring the actual health practitioners, those who do the work and those who are being confronted with the changes, together with the implementers of the change, those who are guiding the transformation. Next, a call was made to also include suppliers and technology businesses and the game changers from further outside the health system. And approaches and forms, that was also part of the question. So how can you bring people together? Were also mentioned. So for example, the World Cafe method, Delphi method, but the most strongly advocated one was, and it was already mentioned in one of the videos, the whole system in the room approach. But we were cautious about not putting too many people in the same room at the same time. Be selective about who you put together, but also include health insurance and other system actors around a theme, and discuss actual problems, because that would be, according to our group, also the best way to really get them to be together. And last but not least, there were two main ideas on how to include also, for example, actors like the competition authority and government bodies and even relevant politicians. First of all, But Nieuwenhuis suggested to create a service ecosystem platform for innovation development. So a real platform where you can meet, but of course also digitally meet, where also and even competitors meet, because that is actually also an issue that you, if you want to work together, but are in competition with each other, how do you do that? And it's necessary for these major changes. And the second idea, and that, then we were brutally stopped in our discussion, but I gather that was about to integrate this kind of meetings, these encounters in education and training, also post-initial and lifelong learning. But actually our meeting ended again with Rick van Buren, who said include these encounters already in the basic training.
Okay, thank you very much for this summary. So if I translate it correctly, it's about getting all the stakeholders involved, but also knowing who your stakeholders are and who to select and who to join, but also have a critical view on that. So not putting too much people together, but make sure that it's an effective way and a platform to do that. And that could then be the role of the school indeed. Yeah.
Yeah, but I want to stress that it is not to be critical about it, but to talk about the real issues.
Yes.
And be selective who you put together, because we're talking major innovation on all levels. Yeah? So that was a part of our discussion.
Yes. Very interesting. Thank you very much. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Petra. I would like to continue to the next, which is Erwin. Oh, you're already there. Hi, Erwin.
Hello,
can you shortly share what was discussed in your group?
Of course, Marloes, thank you. I was in a discussion with Femke Schreuder, Karine Dochen, Erik Koffijberg and Govert Verhoog. And I made some notes and I can share them later. First off, there was the recognition of the struggle of the healthcare system to transform. And we observe that the school is part of an emerging movement within UT, bringing together all kinds of experts across many disciplines who jointly focus on transformation of healthcare. And it is important, and we'd like to stress that there is an academic research program in parallel to the school, where these disciplines really come together. And this is emerging already within BMS Health. I'm also involved in that, as is Karine, for example, and others, and the SHT program within TechMed. We also note that the school will kick up a lot of PR and marketing, which will help us to show the world that UT does more than just technology development, but it has brought together many of the expertises needed for actually transforming healthcare, and that we actually help in making that impact. The school will provide top-level education programs for healthcare leaders, administrators, managers, and the programs may use the participants' case studies for challenge-based learning, and this by itself will generate impact. The school will generate knowledge that existing bachelor master programs like health science, but also other programs, can benefit from. This knowledge can be transformed to challenge-based courses, even graduation tracks. It will offer students probably more internship and graduation positions, and it will strengthen the network of specialists within UT and of the UT with the healthcare sector. Also, a final remark, the scope of the school is not yet very specific, so that needs some more discussion. So what encompasses technology in healthcare, for example? Yeah.
Yes. Thank you very much. So it's great to hear that you already envisioned such a large impact of the school, and that you have such a already ideas on how to create that impact. Also relating to what Petra was telling, that it should be real life cases. So where is transformation already going on, and how to connect that transformation on the different levels? Nice to hear. And about your last remark, I think that's the point for the coming months. So what is the school, and how to further implement it and make give more meaning to the school. So I think that's a very relevant point. Yeah. Thank you very much for sharing, Erwin.
Welcome.
So, Wouter, We are now halfway the pitches, and I'm curious to hear from you if you hear these summaries. What do you think?
Well, I think only one thing. The real work is getting together, and our colleagues, as the chairman and woman just revealed to us, our colleagues are doing this. They get together, they share, and they create. And what I feel listening, but I want to know more. We'll be in touch very soon. Exactly what you're saying. The school could provide all this, I think, and we're looking for focus. And our colleagues are kind of defining the focus with what they bring, what they contribute, and how they want to jump on the wagon of this school, because it's also their school.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much. So let's continue to Lara. I see she's already ready to start with the summary. Yes. Hi. So what was discussed in your subgroup?
Well, in my group, first of all, it was very diversified. We had lots of different perspectives from both students in the tech med or a PhD student from HRM, Stere and Maud. We had Louise and Friedrich from public health and procurement, and Ruud and from the technology department. And we had a really interesting discussion. I'll try to summarize, although Petra and Erwin also touched on some points that we discussed as well. I think that for us, it was very important, the fact that we also need to consider representatives from the commercial sectors, because they can have a different perspective from the provider's healthcare perspective. So it would, their motives could be very different and driven by other goals. So it would be, because we are talking of cross-disciplinary teams and groups, so it would be very interesting to have their perspective as well. And in this regard, also the fact that we should have access to multiple projects and initiatives and cases, I think this also is in line with what Erwin mentioned before. So I believe we should have a sort of a boundary spanner able to really connect all the dots and all the people involved, from practitioners to academics. And in this regard, we also discussed the fact that when we talk about practitioners, we should really account for everyone. So not only doctors and nurses from the hospitals, but really all those associations of GPs, dentists, or physiotherapists that are really working hard within our sector, the healthcare sector, and we should also hear their voices. So make sure that we really connect everyone within this school. We also ended up with a question. Actually, we started with the question of, but how can we really work within the school connecting? So as you said, this could be actually a question for the future months, but it was also important for us to understand how we can reach our goals.
Yes, thank you very much. So indeed, the school should be a linking pin between all those different disciplines, practitioners on all those fields, and everyone that's involved in healthcare. But how can the school be this linking pin? I think that's the big question, and that's definitely something to work on. Thank you very much, Lara, for the summary. Let's go to the final group, which was hosted by Marion. Hi, Marion. Good to see you.
Hi.
So can you shortly summarize what was discussed in your group?
Yes, I think a lot of what was already mentioned before that was discussed also in our group. I think our group had a lot of questions instead of really already having a clear ideas what a school should be. And but I think the one of the main conclusions is that we have as a UT, we have added value to because we have a transdisciplinary way of working and also different disciplines within our university, and that's our unique selling point. We have engineers, we have technological faculties, but also we have social sciences. What Remke, for example, said is the healthcare needs to it has a need to speed up all the implementations. We have already technological solutions, but we have to speed it up, find answers there to bundle our activities. But one of the questions is also, and it is already mentioned, is what is the scope or the focus of the will be the focus of the school? Because the healthcare is so broad, and we have a lot of disciplines, and where are we going to start? But at the other side, I think, is when you look at the movie we saw from the health care organizations, they already have very clear what their problems and questions are. So maybe the starting point is their problems within practice, and we can answer these problems or questions because from a multidisciplinary way of working. So I think that is the main conclusion of our group.
Okay, thank you very much. So you defined two different starting points. The first is the unique starting point that we have as a UT, and the other unique starting point is the cases that are already there in practice. And then the strong point would be to connect those two together.
Yes.
Yes. Perfect. Thank you very much for sharing the summary. So hopefully this already gave you some ideas on what is the school, what can the school do. But of course, as already mentioned, there should be more attention to implementation. But we would like to take this to the next level and ask you to think about how can you maybe add value to the school. So what can you do? Who can you connect with or collaborate with to get to this implementation of the school? So what we will do next is we will divide you into different smaller groups. So we will do a speed date session. You will be paired up or in groups of three. And for 5 minutes, discuss, well, how can I contribute to the school? And what opportunities for collaboration do you see with your discussion partners? So you will be grouped with two others. Try to see if there's some overlap or how you maybe can connect the differences. And we will do that for two rounds. So two times 5 minutes. And you will automatically be referred to the speed date group and back to the plenary session and then to the next rounds of the speed dates. We will see you back in more or less 10 minutes.
Beste collega's van de Universiteit Twente, wat een fantastisch initiatief hebben jullie genomen met deze school. Ik wens jullie... Beste collega's van de Universiteit Twente, beste collega's van de
Welcome back. So because of time constraints, we decided to do only one round of speed dates. Nevertheless, we hope that you had a fruitful discussion and gained some ideas on how to collaborate. From this moment on, the community of the School of Regional Health Care Transformation has started. And what was already mentioned in the pitches of the discussion leaders, the big question is, what's up next? So Wouter, can you maybe shortly tell What's next?
Well, actually, I'm amazed by the avalanche of input we got, but also the number of people. It's astounding how many people are there. And this is a UT-only situation. And we've sent out the invites just 2 weeks ago. I mean, it's amazing. Also, what the chairwoman and women and men of today's sessions revealed to us, it's really the community has started, not only because we do this, but so next month, I hope approaching the 1st of July, which will be a national event for the School of Regional Healthcare Transformation SORT to be launched. We have a conference, a national conference. Well, and I tell you, the people in the video, we invited 8 people. And all of them, they moved away everything in their planning to be on our video. So I think that's a very good sign. We will do seminars. We of course have the region in the class Preso program, a learning and doing project for regional healthcare transformation. We will execute in the coming months. And I think this program also has place for maybe all of our colleagues that are there, but we also will invite anyone who wants to participate the coming months to join in seminars like this. But then not us, the rogue group of 5, but all the participants of today.
Yes, and that's the great connection to the last activity that I would like to introduce during today's session, because we would love to hear from you how you think you can contribute to the school. So what is your expertise? Who would you like to collaborate with? How can we add value to your work? Let us know, and please do that by filling in this short questionnaire of only 6 questions. You can use the QR code on the slide, but the link is also shared in the chat. Fill it in. You can fill that in later today or tomorrow or next week. The survey will be open and will be open for new IDs. So if you have a creative idea, a new idea that you'd like to share, please do so, because we would love to hear from you. That being said, I would like to give the floor to Wouter and Theo for some final remarks about today's session.
Thank you, Marlou. So thank you, and Theo, of course, you're invited again back to the table. This has been astounding for me, for I think all of us. The energy that we heard was there really is golfing also in this studio. Theo, you were sitting there.
Yep. And normally, I suddenly realized that you don't need people in the room in order to get energy, which I always thought that was the real importance. So it was very fascinating to look at what's going on.
Are you happy?
And I'm happy. I'm happy and triggered. Few comments. Immediately, of course, I would like almost to engage in the debate. Yeah, focus, but not too early. Let's take time.
So we don't have focus. Should we have focus? I mean, did we do something wrong
moment,
here?
At a given moment, you get it anyway. But if you look, I mean, we just started, and you should not do this forever, but we have to take time for that. If I look at the so-called SIPs, the strategic investment programs of these universities, they at the average take 2 years with a lot of people to get developed. Now, I don't want to take that long, but I think
we only started 2 months ago.
Precisely. And so the whole idea at the moment is that we need to get focused, and you know, I asked, it's already on the agenda. We're going to put the money where our mouth is, so to speak. We need to deformulate a little bit. It's on the agenda with the shaping. I put it already on the agenda with shaping dialogues with the board of the university. That we're going to trigger this as an extra investment for the next few years, together with some other shaping initiatives. That has to be ready by the end of the year. People know that we're coming with proposals, but by the end of the year, I think the budget is for the next few years has been decided.
So you're talking about budget. So me, I'm as well a scholar. I want to publish my papers, because half of my thesis has not been published. I need this time. I need time for my research proposal. I need time for educational, for working with my students. I don't have time. So my our colleagues.
Already have been I see some people here actually in the in
how can we facilitate?
Screen,
how can we facilitate?
Been talking to some people, at least four people, that to give them a little bit more research time. That should be connected to this, like Marion was saying. We have to develop parallel research program. There is already something from the at least from BMS perspective now, health at BMS. But we would like to insert there a group of people that is doing more on technology and transformation. And by the way, let me say something then also on transformation, just as was being triggered. Is it realistic? That's not the question. Is it going to happen? And so when people say realistic and then they refer, did it happen before? Yeah, there's a difference between a transformation and perhaps a reform or something that's already where it started. The transformation is happening. The question is whether it's going wrong or right, and whether we can play a role in that. So in that sense, it's not necessarily, transformation doesn't mean it necessarily is successful. You might have to survive at a given moment, but hopefully we can make it successful. Same thing is true for the region, the regional aspect. Why? Well, for two reasons, I think. It gives you profile to the outside world, because a lot of people are talking about health innovation or even healthcare innovation systems. And like the highest official from the ministry was saying to us, a lot needs to be done. And Petra said at a given moment, it's a major innovation at all levels. And these levels are changing. So by focusing on the region, I've once learned from some of the people in the health technology that even the flus are different here in Twente than they are when I used to live in Oostgeest. So, I mean, the region does play a role. You can see that. And that gives you a little bit of distinction that it is not a generic transformation that we're talking about. And on top of that, the technology is decentralizing or decentering perhaps even what's happening, denationalizing all healthcare systems. Parts becoming international, look at what's happening with COVID, and more is being put from the hospitals, centrally directed into the neighborhoods, into the homes of the people, into the individual lives.
And that's transformation.
And that's the nature of the transformation.
We
need to pay attention to, and that's why we stressed a little bit this regional as a core, as already a start to have your own identity.
We will talk about this further. We have learned from our colleagues, but also I have to stress that the School of Regional Healthcare Transformation, we will work together with the yep. people that were in the interview, in the video. We will work with Radboud University, but also with our colleagues at the University of Groningen, UMCG, MST, ZGT, OLVG. We will pick up the invite from the Ministry of Health by Erik Geerts, who is resigning, and will do a lot of great other work in another sector, not so far from healthcare. We will work with Reshape. We will work with DIRMI Institute. We will work with health innovation initiatives across the country. And we dearly hope that we today started a community of learning, a community of sharing, a community of collaboration among ourselves at the University of Twente with the people in healthcare. Healthcare system in the Netherlands, in Holland, we are really, really proud of, and we can even improve better. And beyond, there's a whole world to reaching out to us, to our knowledge, and which is outside of the Netherlands. We start here. Hope to see you very soon, and we'll cross our minds and notes together at the 1st of July. Thank you so much. Thank you, Theo. Thank you, Marloes, and many people. Thank you, Roy, Han, Chris, Dick, Jacqueline, Eric, Bob, Rogier, Marloes again, because you're two, Mark, Theo again. The people, the guys from the Solid Focus, and of course all the executives in healthcare who were participating, and there are much more, many more, and of course, last but not least, our colleagues at the University of Twente. Thank you, see you next time.
Beste collega's van de Universiteit Twente, wat een fantastisch initiatief hebben jullie genomen met deze school. Ik wens jullie dan ook ontzettend veel succes, maar ook vooral heel veel plezier en genieten. Want het is natuurlijk wel een ontdekkingsreis wat je gaat doen. Wat zou ik mee willen geven als bestuurder van het Radboud UMC, los van dat we graag samen met jullie optrekken natuurlijk in deze, is toch eigenlijk jezelf uitnodigen, nieuwsgierig zijn en durven te gaan zitten op de stoel van die ander. Om dat perspectief van die ander te nemen. Soms verras je dat, brengt je tot nieuwe creatieve inzichten. Verbindingen met mensen, met sectoren die je eigenlijk niet zo vertrouwd zijn. Hoe verrassend is dat als je dat bij elkaar legt met alle kennis en kunde die jullie hebben, wat er dan gaat gebeuren aan misschien nieuwe gedachten, nieuwe diensten, nieuwe producten. Dat zien we natuurlijk in het wetenschappelijk onderzoek. Die crossovers brengen eigenlijk de grootste stappen voorwaarts. Zo gaat het ook met gedrag, zo gaat het ook met systeemveranderingen. Dus laten we elkaar uitnodigen, een mooie gezelschap om goede noten te kraken en nieuwe creativiteit te creëren. Veel succes, veel plezier en tot ziens, hoop ik. Dag.
Ik denk dat het enorm belangrijk is voor echte duurzame oplossingen voor de zorg. En dat gaat dus over transformatie. Dat je zorgt dat je, als er problemen zijn, inclusief gaat kijken naar welke scholars, welke mensen uit de universiteit kunnen hier nou iets zinnigs over zeggen. En dat betekent dus dat je mensen bij elkaar gaat brengen als technici, mensen die verstand hebben van gedrag en sociologie, mensen die verstand hebben van economie, allerlei verschillende perspectieven. En dat je die rondom een probleem om tafel brengt, transdisciplinair nadenkend. En zonder dat we dat soort beweging leren maken, zitten we te veel op ons eigen domein. En het is juist fantastisch om rond een probleem te merken dat je buurman een compleet andere kijk heeft dan jij, en de andere buurman weer een heel andere kijk. Die dingen bij elkaar leggend kun je oplossingen gaan uitkristalliseren en wegen inslaan en daarmee experimenteren, waarmee je echt verder komt. Veel verder dan vanuit alleen uit je eigen domein. Dus fantastisch dat er een school voor transformatie opgericht wordt die al die perspectieven bij elkaar gaat brengen. Vanuit de zorg sprekend, dat hebben wij nodig. Dank je wel.
Oké, dames en heren. Het ziekenhuis van de toekomst is een ziekenhuis zonder muren. We zullen zien, met name door data, dat steeds vaker de zorg echt door de organisaties heen, om de patiënt, om de burger heen georganiseerd gaat worden. Een enorme verandering, eigenlijk van het bed naar alles passend in de omgeving om de mens thuis heen. Dat vraagt nogal wat voor die mensen in de ziekenhuizen. En de vraag is, hebben we daar niet de juiste hulp nodig? Bijvoorbeeld van mensen zoals jullie. Twee thema's wil ik even noemen. Innovatie vraagt om sociale transformatie, om andere vormen van leiderschap en andere vormen van elkaar leren en met elkaar omgaan. En hoe mooi zou het zijn als jullie je kennis inbrengen in de ziekenhuizen om de professionals te leren om die transformatie ook echt te maken, om die verandering ook echt vanuit kracht te doorleven. Die hele sociale kant is superbelangrijk. Een tweede belangrijk punt is whole system in the room. Dus die veranderingen zullen plaatsvinden met andere partijen dan alleen het ziekenhuis of de burger-patiënt. Maar ook een techbedrijf, ook een verzekeraar, ook een gemeente, ook een huisarts. En hoe is dat als die patiënten samen met dat ecosysteem komen in één kamer om een oplossing te bedenken met elkaar, in plaats van langs elkaar vanuit de silo's? En daar hebben jullie natuurlijk ook met jullie kennis en expertise een superbelangrijke rol. Meer vanuit een labomgeving. Nou, in ieder geval vanuit OLFG Amsterdam. Wij zouden supergraag die lijn naar Twente leggen. En weten zeker dat we ook heel veel van jullie kunnen leren. Dus zet hem op.
Zorg staat voor een enorme uitdaging. Dat is eigenlijk niks nieuws. En we weten eigenlijk dat we daarvoor een transformatie nodig hebben. En met dat kleine beetje, iedere keer op keer innoveren wat we nu doen, gaan we er niet komen. En waarom we jullie nodig hebben, is om met ons te leren hoe we moeten transformeren. Daar hebben we sociale innovatie voor nodig, daar hebben we technologische innovatie voor nodig. En we moeten leren hoe we in organisaties echt die stap gaan maken, mensen meenemen en kracht organiseren. En als ik heel eerlijk ben, zonder jullie kennis gaat ons dat niet lukken.
Ja, de TU Twente is een van de geweldige kennisinstituten die wij hebben in Nederland en die ook internationaal toonaangevend onderzoekswerk doen op tal van gebied. En zeker ook op het gebied van de geneeskunde. En wat alleen nog vaak veel beter kan, en daar daag ik jullie ook voor uit, is om al die kennis die jullie in dat instituut hebben opgebouwd in de loop der jaren, om dat ook voor zover dat relevant is, ja, zeg maar, om te zetten in voor patiënten en consumenten relevante waardeproposities. En dat betekent ook een stuk ondernemerschap. En wij zijn eigenlijk al in het hele land actief met start-ups en scale-ups. En ik zou jullie echt willen uitnodigen om daar veel meer de verbinding ook aan te gaan, zodat wij weer kunnen helpen van hoe doe je dat dan, hoe maak je een businessplan, waar haal je de financiering vandaan. Omdat ik denk dat als we dat gaan doen, dan hebben we daar straks niet de vruchten alleen maar van voor de Nederlandse patiënt, maar dan kunnen ook sommige van die ideeën uitgroeien tot internationale ondernemingen. En dat is dan weer een stukje motor van de economie van Nederland voor de toekomst. En ik kijk er naar uit om die samenwerking met jullie aan te gaan.